Hello, everyone. Good evening. My name is Chirayu Bhatt, and I'm going to be your host for this lecture in the recently launched CEPT AU lecture series. CEPT AU lecture series has been launched to invite globally renowned intellectuals and professionals to share their experiences with the public at large in Ahmedabad. Before we begin, may I request you to silence your mobile phones, and if there are people who want to come up front, there's lots of space here. May I request Dr. Bimal Patel, President of CEPT University, to introduce our speaker for today.
So welcome, everybody, and thank you, Professor Oldenburg, for agreeing to do this talk for us. I'm going to give you some information about him. Philip Oldenburg is a political scientist specializing in South Asia. He has taught at Columbia University since 1977. At that time, he joined as a member of the regular faculty of the Political Science Department, and since 1990, he is an adjunct faculty member there. He has served as director and associate director of the South Asian Institute. He has also taught courses on the politics of South Asia at the School of Advanced International Studies of the Johns Hopkins University, the University of Texas at Austin, University of Chicago, the University of Pennsylvania, and the University of Illinois. He's senior fellow at Institute of Social Sciences, New Delhi, since 2003. Professor Oldenburg is the author of Big City Government in India, Counselor, Administrator, and Citizen in Delhi. Apart from this book, he has published many articles in scholarly journals, mainly on Indian politics. He has edited or co-edited 10 volumes in the Asia Society's India Briefing Series. The most recent, co-edited with Alisa Ares, is titled India Briefing, Take Off at Last. Take off at last, question. Well, his most recent scholarly article is Face to Face with the Indian State, a Grassroots View in Experiencing the State, which is edited by John Jacobson and Lloyd Rudolph. His most recent book is India, Pakistan, and Democracy, Solving the Puzzle of Divergent Paths. Professor Oldenburg has spent a lot of time in India. He has spent a total of more than a decade in India since his first trip in 1964, doing research, consulting, and assisting delegations. He has been an election observer for the National Democratic Institute in Bangladesh in 1996 and Pakistan 2002, and was member of the Council of Foreign Relations, Asia Society Independent Task Force on U.S. Policy towards South Asia. Professor Oldenburg has completed his Ph.D. in Political Science from the University of Chicago in 1974. His current research interests include elections in India and a project on state activity at the grassroots in India. Professor Oldenburg, thank you very much for agreeing to do this talk. Please.
Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here. My first visit to Ahmedabad since 1970. So far, enjoying it very much. I'm going to be not so much lecturing you on the facts of who or what the Indian politician is, or ought to be, for that matter, but rather to present really an outline of the project that I am just starting to work on, which has the working title of The Indian Politician. And it's a working title that I have for myself as much as for an audience such as this one. So I'm looking forward to spending a fair amount of time with questions and comments and elaborations from you about what I'm about to say. When we see the phrase or hear the phrase of the Indian politician, I'm guessing anyhow, you, and if you're like most people, the words that you would put next to that are dishonest, corrupt, unprincipled, power hungry. The best might be necessary evil. A politician is a necessary evil in a democracy. You have to have them, but you don't have to like them. I hope to focus on the necessary part rather than the evil part. I figured the evil part is pretty well covered. And I'm doing this because, based to some extent, what I'll talk about, on my own experience talking to politicians and thinking about the issue of who the politicians are and why they operate the way they do, is that we devalue the extent to which politicians, with all their faults and rough edges, contribute positively to the functioning of democracy. They're not just necessary, they are in fact a positive influence. And that's my working hypothesis, if I have to have one. But I'm, as I say, still exploring the landscape, but this is the bias that I have. And that bias has come largely from my own experience. To organize what I'm going to say and present in this respect, I'm going to steal a device that was used by A.K. Ramanujan in a wonderful essay called Is There an Indian Way of Thinking? In which he starts by saying that sentence, that question, varies depending on which word you emphasize. So I'm going to talk about, say, am I talking about the Indian politician, or the Indian politician, or the Indian politician? That is to say, taking the last politicians, or as opposed to non-politicians, Indian as opposed to outside of India, leaving it to democracies. And then, who is the singular Indian, who the singular politician might be? I'm actually quite amazed, as a little footnote here, to realize that no one has used this title for a book. It seems to me that this would be a bestseller no matter what you put into it. But it's not there. And I said, well, I wonder whether there are other things. So I checked out in Google whether there's a book on the American politician, and according to at least the quick Google search that I did, there isn't one of that either. So there's scope for someone in the audience to go to America and do the same thing. We have much the same idea about politicians there, I think. Let me start with the. Is the singular politician male or female? Can't be half male or half female, or 50% or 40% and 60%. Is the Indian politician young or old or middle-aged? Is the Indian politician of a particular caste or class, upper, lower, middle? Is the Indian politician educated or not educated? What language does the Indian politician speak? Where does the Indian politician live? All of these things seem to me to be necessarily things that we have to explore. We have to figure out who the actually existent politicians are, but more as important is who or what do people, when they think of, when they conceive, if you ask somebody, what are you thinking of? What's the image that you have in your mind of the Indian politician along these dimensions? Male, female, old, young, rural, urban, educated, uneducated? What's the image? Well, there are a couple of sources for image. It used to be, actually, you could say very simply, the image may be most carefully shown in Lakshman's cartoons or other political cartoons, but I've noticed the political cartoons have disappeared from the newspapers, by and large, replaced by the cartoons that appear on television screens in one form, sometimes live people actually acting like cartoon characters, it seems to me, as an outsider, from time to time. And the image of those, so certainly the image of the politician judging, I mean, this is now really snap judgment from looking at TV things, but and also cartoons, is overwhelmingly male. There are very few cases of, some women. They're overwhelmingly loud and shouting and so forth. The cartoon characters tend to be dressed in traditional dress rather than quote-unquote traditional dress, rather than in quote-unquote Western dress. And some of that's sort of percolated into the onto the TV screens as well. But it doesn't get us very far to think about by looking at those sources, as it were, of what the images are of the Indian politician. I think it's something that actually, I don't know, something that I may do in this project, but I can conceive of doing a sort of a sub-project of just asking people to literally draw the Indian politician and see what people would come up with. One critical element of this is that politicians, the Indian politician, has changed over time. The Indian politician was at one time the descendant of the freedom fighter, of the nationalist movement leader. The Indian politician has moved into being, to some extent, a former social movement leader of some sort. And I think there is something else in this project that needs to be traced. What are the, as it were, over time transformations of the image, whatever it might be, of the Indian politician? One way around this, of course, would be to try and think about what's the average Indian politician. Okay, we know that roughly 40% of Indian politicians, and I'll be coming to how I'm defining politicians a bit later, that approximately 40% are women, if you add in all of those women panchayat members. But certainly at the national level, it's much less. But what does it mean to say that the average number of, well, the number of women in parliament is something in the order now of between 10 and 15%, it varies a bit, which people have argued necessitates having reservations for women. But what does that mean? Because the next question is, well, okay, so even if they were 50%, would they be a powerful 50%? We want to look at the ministries, for example, because backbenchers don't matter that much. And so I think dealing with trying to come up with an average on these dimensions, how old, how young, what's the average age, what's the average or median age, if you wish, what's the median age, what's the median sex, as it's, so to speak, of the Indian politicians, however we define them, is a difficult thing to grasp. We're still not there at what the Indian politician is. Perhaps what we need to do is come up with exemplars this one strategy. I'll look at some Indian politicians who are women and some Indian politicians who are men and some Indian politicians who are old and some are young and some are this one and so forth. The trouble with India is it's too large to begin to get that kind of coverage because there are just too many special places. That's the wonderful thing about this country, isn't it? That you can go anywhere, the language changes every, the dialects certainly change every half day's journey. The ecology changes, everything gets transformed and it's marvelous so that to try and pick out sort of exemplar politicians in each of these places I think is fraught in terms of coming to. We can get the illusion, it's better than thinking about a singular politician, but I think it's not going to get me that far. the Indian policies as opposed to the non-Indian. Are Indian politicians different in important ways from American politicians? I must say that when I came to do my field work in India in 1969-70, I worked on municipal government in Delhi, the book that was mentioned, came out of that field work. I came from having spent 3 years in Chicago, the Chicago of Richard J. Daley the First, a place where, let me put it politely, corruption was not unknown. Those of you who look at, keep track of the American press know that in terms of the way the police operate in Chicago is not all that different from the way the police operate in India. It was a smooth transition from Chicago politics to Indian politics in 1969-70. Things may have changed, and I'm not at all entirely sure, given the state of the current presidential election, and of course we can talk about that if you prefer in the US, that, you know, if you took a look at these two sets of candidates that we've got over there, whether we can't simply say that that Donald Trump is somehow a more capable, better politician than anyone in this country. And is acting quite similarly to a fair number of politicians here. I think there is, though, and is likely to be, that the Indian politician is going to differ in certain critical ways from other politicians, in that the Indian politician is operating fundamentally in a parliamentary system, which depends to a significant extent on having strong parties with strong leadership. And the American system and presidential systems more generally are much more personalist, believe it or not, and do not have the kinds of strength of party that parliamentary systems are required to have. A presidential system is designed to make sure that voters don't have people on the extremes to vote for. That may not be happening in this current American election, but the extremists, both succeeding in, say, European politics in Italy and so on, are doing well, as in the Le Pen's party in France, or in the various groups that have emerged from time to time in parliamentary systems, because in typical parliamentary systems, and particularly those with proportional representation, you get the representation of a broad range of political ideas and of political personalities. The other major difference is between Indian politics, or not between, but a sort of clubbing and something that I want to take a look at, is the extent to which democratic politics is about having programs on which voters vote, and those programs then are executed by a civil service. That's the typical model in India. It is not the model in America, and it is not, in fact, the model that operates in some extent on the ground in India as well. The model in America has always been that the congressman, the local politician, is there to service his constituents in a serious way. He does it in order to get reelected, but it is also normatively correct. It's not so much that the policies, yes, you have a role in forming laws and judging policies and so forth, but most of what politicians do, it's recognized in the US, is deal with the day-to-day issues that arise from those policies, in particular the problems that your constituents have, in particular servicing, making sure that they get government contracts into their constituency and so forth. This is all very familiar territory to someone who thinks about American politics, and it is, I think, very interestingly, very familiar to those who think about Indian politics. The difference being that everybody that I know of the educated classes thinks that this is a violation of democratic principles. But I, as an American and a Chicagoan, so to speak, think it's a perfectly normal way of conducting democratic politics. It's what we would call a quid pro quo politics. You give me your vote, I'll give you a benefit. That benefit will be helping you out in certain ways, getting you out of jail, perhaps, keeping you out of jail. You give me the votes. You give me a little money, too. We do that. But votes are the important part. And that's quid pro quo politics. There's nothing inherently undemocratic about it. And I can perhaps go into that in some more detail. But that's my perspective. Now, this comparative part of this project, I hope to do more towards the end of the project when I'm a little bit further on in the sorts of things that I'll be talking about now. but it's there, and I think that that's something that will be important, an important part. The third issue is, who are the politicians? Now, I've met a fair number of Indian politicians, but unlike, perhaps many of you, my experience was first with a year doing my field research for my PhD in the old city of Delhi, following a municipal councillor around, interviewing municipal councillors, talking to their chamchas, talking to their right-hand men, not getting much higher than that. So my initial real sense of who the politician was somebody at a local level. I continued working on politics and government, actually, more in the countryside in UP. And again, the politicians that I came across were sarpanches, by and large, people in the panchayati raj system, actually at a time before the constitutional amendment was passed, and so not with much formal power, but they existed. I mean, it's a mistake to think that panchayati raj begins after 1996 or so. It in fact was very much there, particularly in North India in the 50s and 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s when I was doing some of this research. So I met those people. So my view is a bottom-up view of who the politicians are, and it's given me a rather different perspective, I think, and something that is, perhaps I can contribute. One of the politicians I interviewed, one of the counselors I interviewed in Delhi, I said, you know, why do you do this? You're a politician, you're a counselor in Delhi, and I suspect the same is true of a counselor in Ahmedabad or almost anywhere else. They were, first of all, work long hours. I don't know how many of you are aware of this, but at least every politician that I've ever come across thinks nothing of the fact that some constituent or the other is knocking on his door at 5 in the morning and expecting him to be polite and to do something. And they frequently don't go to bed until midnight. This is not just true at election time. This is sort of, the people think that this is, they are public servants. They're seen this way. It's certainly the people at the low level. They're not way up on their high and mighty scale. In fact, they're making most of their living doing other things. And so they feel perfectly willing, and I think it's a wonderful strength of Indian democracy that they are willing to do this, to say to these guys, you know, we give you your votes, you give us service. And they're not unwilling to push it. So I asked this counselor, and what do they get out of it? I mean, you may not believe you can, let's hold it in abeyance. They don't get out of it, by and large, much money. Some take a little bit, but on the whole, most of them are doing it for nothing, or close to nothing. So I asked this guy, why do you do it? And his answer was, "Dekhiye hum ek chunav mein aaye kisi ke sang kaam kar rahe the, aur baad mein hum nashe mein aaye politics ka." And I think that that is a key to understanding, at least for me anyhow, and one of the reasons I'm pursuing this project, why these guys do it. I mean, that's the real puzzle. Why do they do it? And the answer is that they feel they have to somehow. They're addicts. They get excited by it, but they feel they can't do it otherwise. Another way to do this, say, a little bit more formally, is to turn to Max Weber in saying that politicians have a calling for politics, as well, in many cases, of an inclination to live off politics. This is what Weber argues, that in his wonderful essay, Politics as a Vocation, that some people, some politicians live for politics, and some politicians live off politics, make money from it, whatever you might want to say. But the idea of a vocation, of a calling, is something like this addiction or intoxication idea. It's somewhere in the same scale. That is to say, it's as if somebody picks you up by the scruff of the neck and says, you are going to be a politician and you can't do anything about it. That's your calling. Usually vocations, the vocation to the priesthood or the vocation to a particular profession is what people talk about. And I don't see any reason to think of why you can't have politicians with a vocation, and that it's a useful starting point as we think about politicians, to think of them having a vocation, a calling, rather than an inclination to make lots of money by taking commissions from construction contracts or whatever the latest way of making money is. Because it seems to me to explain a great deal about why we have so many people in politics when I don't actually see them making all that much money. The two, of course, are not incompatible. You can have a calling and decide to make sure that you make some money as well, that you live both, that you become a professional politician in that sense, as well as someone who feels they can, that they have a calling, that they have a skill also that that will make them a successful politician. We can array these politicians on the one hand, the people, particularly at times of great crisis, and things like the freedom movement and so forth. You can think of lots of people who were selfless in their devotion to the political. The people who worked very hard in the Constituent Assembly drafting a constitution were not making money out of that. They did it because they were patriotic, if you wish. They did it because they were devoted, but they did it because it was their duty. They did it because they felt they had to. The people in that early generation of politicians who attended Parliament religiously, and Nehru in the forefront, even though it was very tempting to stay in your office and do something else, but the idea that you had to show that you were doing politics as well as actually just being elected to office was probably much stronger then than it is now, although I don't think it's entirely gone, at least in my limited experience of parliamentarians. But putting these people aside, let us first also remember that there are people who have a calling for politics who are not just in political office or having been defeated in an election, or the people I'm going to be talking about a little bit more later on, the people surrounding politicians in parties and elsewhere. There are, I think, a whole range of people who have a calling for politics. And you can find them in amongst the professionals, amongst lawyers, for example. You can find them amongst bureaucrats, businessmen, and so on. I want to focus in my project on, just for the sake of argument, and Weber talks about full-time politicians and part-time politicians, and occasional politicians, the people who show up during campaigns, for example, versus the people who are working all the time, thinking all the time about politics. I want to look at the full-time politicians rather than the occasional politicians, But I think there are many more of them than we recognize. Full-time, I'm defining very crudely at for the time being, as those people who are spending the equivalent of a full-time job. In an American terms, and I might as well use them, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, 40-hour weeks, as it were, that's full-time. Doing politics in one form or the other. That means that there's plenty of time to do other things, and I think many, many full-time politicians are also full-time, or at least part-time, but many full-time, in their professions, as lawyers, as doctors in some cases, or in business. I have met many a politician who is the third or fourth son of a business family. And the business people say, well, and sometimes it's if it's the third son, we have one guy and one person who really knows the business and can deal with the accountants, another one who he is a lawyer, so he can deal with our court cases, and might as well take this guy who's not really interested, likes to talk and hang around, let him be a politician. He can be useful. And so the family, as it were, carries, or the firm carries certain people who are doing full-time politics because at certain critical moments it can be useful, and they allow that to happen. You see this certainly in the countryside among certain farmers who for much of the year have nothing better to do than to sit around and talk politics, and some of them actually do politics as well. These days we have now increasing numbers of students who decide never to leave college, or seem to decide never to leave college. There's a wonderful book on this subject by Craig Jeffrey called Time Pass. It's about doing time pass in Meerut. And these are guys who are 30 years old, and they haven't yet got the job they really want. But in the meantime, they are running the Students' Union. They are helping out in certain ways. They're sometimes knocking people over and things like that, but we'll leave that aside. You've got also these days a fair number of people who work in NGOs, and one of the major pipelines, for example, of people I'm counting as politicians, that is to say sarpanches or people with significant power in the Panchayati Raj system, are women, often, who have been good workers in some in a saving society or some NGO, of women's NGO, and the NGO says, why don't you go into politics? You have the gift of the gab, you're good, people like you, you smile well or something like this. We'll support you. And so I've run into lots of women sarpanches who are not there because their husband is pulling their strings, but are there because they had graduated, as it were, from work NGO work into pure political work. And I want to look at those kinds of people, and that's in the NGO sector. And the NGO sector in certain parts, certainly is, in particular in the countryside, is huge. The most visible full-time politician is, of course, the candidate for political office. And I've done some I'm going to read a little bit of this because otherwise I'll get the numbers wrong. I've done some very rough calculations about how many there are and where they're contesting for office. The standard estimate is something like 30 lakh elected representatives, of which 25 lakh are in the Panchayati Raj institutions. I've attempted a more modest estimate, taking only the Pradhan or Sarpanch numbers and adding in their single opponent, in other words, doubling the number of pradhans that exist in the system. That gives us 313,000, 3,13,000 politicians in the countryside. In my observation, not very extensive, I must say, but to the extent that I've seen pradhans in action, he's constantly, or she, on the job. Certainly there are plenty of Pradhan Patni's style thing, that is to say, where because the seat has now become reserved for a woman, the ex-Pradhan puts his wife up. This has been known to happen in the chief ministership of Bihar. But interestingly enough, as did happen a little bit in Bihar, the wife stops doing entirely being the puppet of the husband. And in many cases, this has been documented with respect to the Andhra Pradesh legislature, the party selects a wife in that case, MLA, a sitting MLA, to contest the next election because the sitting MLA is someone they want to move out of politics. He's ineffective or corrupt or whatever it is, but he's too powerful to just drop from the ticket or deny a ticket to, so they give a ticket to his wife on the grounds, and this way they figure that they can be influential, and in fact this is a calculation that I suspect is made more often than we realize. Anyhow, another 46,000 after this 3,13,000 are councillors in municipal bodies. Members of parliament constitute 0.2% of the number of full-time politicians by this calculation, and I estimate that another 0.4% would take account of their opposing candidates. Members of the legislative assemblies would constitute 1.1% of full-time politicians. Another 4.7% would be their major opponents. All of these, what I would call headline politicians, add up to 6.4% of the total, a little less than 25,000 people. Now, I'm not going to interview 25,000 people, and I'll talk about it a little bit further on. I don't want to just interview them. I don't want to just collect statistics about them. I want to observe them in action to give some sense of what they do and how they what their motives are and so on. In any event, so we're talking if I add all of this up, it roughly 4 lakh politicians in total. And with those percentages, of which what's left behind, that 313,000, is 81% of the full-time politicians in this entirely, back of the, what's the term, back of the envelope calculation that I've made, very temporary. If anything, I think it underestimates the number of politicians because I've not talked about the full-time politicians that we all know about. Most importantly, the dalals, the brokers, the people who are sometimes lawyers, sometimes sitting around in the law court, sometimes they're in some cooperative society, sometimes they're just what Anirudh Krishna has called a nayaneta, young men who have the high school education, who can't find a job that's suitable to their talents, there's no room for them to work in the farm because the farms are too small. There's no living to be made from agriculture. And so they develop into brokers in a good sense, people who go with people to the town to deal with the bureaucracy, go to town to deal with the bureaucracy, of course, including the police, particularly the police. And these are incredibly important elements of the political system that make it work in a serious way. And some of these people wind up later on, if they do well, as politicians. They start working their way up the ladder. And, of course, that ladder, although in general, is a very short ladder. I mean, you can make it up one or two or three layers. But let's not forget that there have been politicians, and arguably you can say that about someone like David Gowda, who starts as basically a local politician and winds up as Prime Minister of India. I don't think that's ever going to happen again, not because of what David Gowda did or didn't do, but because it's a very difficult path. But there is, in fact, a startling number of people with that kind of links to local bodies, and a lot of them, I think, start out in just this form of Anirudh Krishna, who's a scholar at Duke University, calls Nayaneta. which he gets from observing what goes on in parts of Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, where he's done his research. These, of course, Nayaneta and others of the Chamcha variety and so forth, take flight at election time, where they're absolutely necessary for organizing rallies for some parts of the country, intimidating voters. In other parts, just simply being the bodies that go around yelling slogans and so forth. Some of them get started as a young age. Every election campaign that I've ever seen always involves children having a great time. They're taught slogans, and people follow them around. My favorite of this was one that I saw in a municipal election in Delhi, where there were literally like a Pied Piper. There was one sort of young man with about, 20 small children. This was a then Junsung versus Congress campaign, and this was a Junsung procession. And the slogan and response was, and this refers to something that was said in 1947, Bapuji ne kya kaha tha, Congress ko tod do. Which is true, what Gandhi said. Gandhi said that it should be dissolved. And so here was this guy going, Bapuji ne kya kaha tha, and all these five-year-olds saying, Congress ko tod do. Well, as a socialite, they had a great time. Everybody was smiling and so forth. That's a great time. I've seen in election time, each election seems to have a special little shtick that they have. I mean, in some places, I'm told it's a hologram. In other places, it's other things. In this particular case, in the back area in Delhi, in one election, I think probably 1989 that I was looking at, in mohalla after mohalla, the thing was, before the candidate shows up to give an election speech, there's usually hours sometimes of time to fill because the people have come, it's been announced for this meeting, the guy is running late and so forth. So you've got to fill the program. And so all the local leaders get up and make speeches. And at this time, in order to keep the audience and so on, they had, these were 10-year-olds, boys, the ones that I saw were all boys, getting up, all dressed properly, and they would give political speeches. I mean, they clearly didn't know what they were talking about, but they had all the mannerisms of the politicians down pat, and everybody was just having very funny, very clever, and so on. And they were doing, and these kids were really into it, as you can imagine, memorizing. They'd heard it so often because it's the same speech again and again and again and again, and there they were, and everybody cheering them on and so forth, and it was great fun. Now, the question is, when I ask some of these politicians, when you were 10 years old, did you do this sort of thing? Were you involved in it? Let's see, what is the entry there into the political career? So I'm going to try, in order to do this, I mean, I don't know, I see this as a very long-term project, years, or less if I get encourage some people to help out, as it were, and do ancillary projects. The first thing to think about is where do I go to talk about these things? Now, I first want to identify full-time politicians. And here, one person has proposed to me, and I think it's a good idea, and I'd be interested in anyone thinking, give me suggestions on this, that the best way to do it would be to go, particularly for the countryside, because I want to look at the modal politician. I want to look at these people from below. I want to look at the local people. I'm going to try and shy away for till the end, as long as I can, from the headliners, the people who show up in the front pages of the newspapers. I want to go to the district towns and talk to the newspaper stringers and say, who are the politicians here? Tell me who they are and introduce me. And work by then talking to those politicians and developing, as it were, a sense of the political layer in each particular place. Now, I don't know how much of that I can do. It's limited by the languages that I know or don't know to some extent. And then once I find who they are, again, I'm not going to go and give them a questionnaire and say, how old are you and what's your caste and so on. I'll talk to them. I'll have conversations. That's my way of doing it. And with luck, and this is what I've done in my previous research, I'll be sitting around watching as they interact with people and getting a sense of how politicians deal with their constituents, deal with their fellow politicians, from just simply observing it. Again, I think we underestimate enormously the extent to which political relationships, political relations cross party lines, cross other kinds of lines, even religious lines, all sorts of things, that their politicians share a sense of being a politician, share a sense of an esprit, as it were, of a calling, of a group, which at times overwhelms partisan differences and serious differences. The most recent example I can think of was when recently A.P. Bardhan of the CPI died. And one of the most prominent people who called for condolences and so forth and who spoke up was Nitin Gadkari of the BJP, or as he says himself, a pure RSS man. Why? He said, when I came to Delhi as a young politician, Bardhan was helpful, was someone I got on with. I see him as a mentor. I see him as a wonderful man across party lines. I think one of the reasons politicians or parliamentarians and legislators don't like to welcome outsiders into their spaces is because, in fact, there's a great deal of cross-party, relationships which don't fit the normal patterns. And it's something that I think needs to be explored. Why? Because in normal times, in particular, this is what keeps the system going. That you have to give your opponents, you have to give your political opponents in a certain way the benefit of the doubt when it comes to whether they're decent human beings or not. On the other side, I'm going to try and look at how politicians are portrayed. These are sort of ancillary parts of this project. Reading memoirs, reading scholarly studies, reading the newspapers, watching TV. I want to say that I'm not happy with the immediate reaction of my fraternity, that is to say political scientists, all of whom these days, or almost all of whom, seem to think that the only knowledge worth having is knowledge that can be expressed in numbers and equations and processed with a computer. I don't like that particularly. I'm not against computers and numbers, but I think we have to be balanced about it. So I think we need to move away from most of what's been gone analysis that I've found on Indian politicians, who the Indian politician is, which is looked at, which is important data, but it doesn't go far enough, of the extent to which, for example, the previously excluded are now members of parliament, the previously excluded are now members of political parties, and measured in terms of things and terms like the silent revolution and so forth. Some of this is very important, the extent to which women and marginal groups have come up in participation and voting and things of that sort, but it's not the whole story by any means. I have a few problems, and I'll just end with these. Very particular problems, but I figure might as well say something about them. I'm not happy with the way people interpret the criminal case affidavits that we now have about politicians. The newspapers always headline the fact that whatever percentage of it is, 15% of elected legislators or 15% of whatever, are people who have criminal cases against them. I wouldn't mind that. That's important data. But the trouble is that no one, as far as I know, has ever, I've not seen any serious scholarly study that would say, hey, let me go to the courts and find out what exactly these cases are. Are these cases where, for example, I have to go half a step back to make this point, from my own experience in America, where in one particular case, which I won't go into, something happened, and the arresting officer said, well, we'll charge this person for this crime, which of course won't stick because it's not, but it'll keep him in jail. And when the prosecutor gets around to looking at it, he'll say, well, there's no evidence for this. We'll get him on a lesser charge. In other words, a lot of the criminal cases are filed as bargaining chips in order to achieve certain other results. And I think somebody's got to take a close look at each one of the cases. Politicians, in fact, scream about this. They say, these are political cases. Anyone can file an FIR, in fact, do all the time. Just because an FIR is filed, you have to put it on your affidavit because you've been brought up, but it doesn't mean that there's any necessarily a crime there. So I would really like to know who the real criminals are, who the people are that are in fact, even they may not have been convicted yet or their appeals may not have run out, but by looking at the actual cases, you can say, no, this is not political, these are not fake cases, these are not real cases. And I haven't seen that done. I don't know whether I can do it, but it seems somebody ought to do it. Similarly, the assets declaration that we have about it. We now know that politicians are all rich. But the assumption that's made in every newspaper article that I've ever seen so far, I think, I mean, that's itself is an exaggeration, is that the assumption that just because someone's assets have gone up from 10 lakhs to 10 crores means that they've made that money through politics with bribery. Right. This involves the fact that they've made this money and they're now declaring it, which is a bit odd. The fact of the matter is, in many, many cases, the assets are dependent on the skyrocketing value of land, sometimes agricultural land, sometimes urban land, particularly urban land. And you can easily move from owning property worth 10 lakhs to owning property worth 10 crores. I should add that at the present, my wife and I have a house in Gurgaon, and it's very clear that the assets, that the crorepatis, who were lakhpatis before, are mainly crorepatis because they've just sat there and waited for their land price to go up. We need to adjust for that in those affidavits. Most important for me, I think, in certain ways, is the problem of immediately identifying every politician, first and foremost, by their caste or community or family. In my relatively limited experience, is that if to say that person A is a family member along with person B doesn't tell you whether they are beloved brothers or brothers who've been in court for the last 25 years fighting over property. I've known in one case a politician who was in the Congress Party and whose brother, real brother, was in the then Junsung. And when the Junsungi brother decided to switch to the Congress, his brother, the congressman, immediately shifted to another party. He said, I cannot be in the same party with my brother. Now, the notion that somehow just because somebody is of such and such caste or such and such community, therefore they are, I mean, that tells you something about them. Again, I'm a bit sensitive about this in terms of community, for example. The idea that somehow there is something called the Muslim vote. When someone who has had some experience in Lucknow, as I've had, and I'm sure the same is true of people in Hyderabad, know that the Muslim papers over the Shia and the Sunni, who in fact have rioted against each other in Lucknow, much more than Hindus and Muslims have rioted against each other. And this is true throughout the social stratification system. Knowing a person's caste, knowing a person's community does not tell you what the political dynamics are. And we can't just get away with just papering that over. And finally, this is my little hobby horse, so I'm going to finish with my hobby horse, which is I don't like the word dynasty applied to politicians. Dynasties, it seems to me, suggest that the eldest son is given a legitimacy to rule on the part of people because of their blood, descent by blood. I won't go into the details of this, but I think it's much more useful to think of political family firms, politicians that are people who have come out of literally growing up in a political family where politics is bread and butter, in American terms, where they in fact get their name recognition. There's so-and-so's, just because so-and-so's son, the son of a politician, by the time he's gone through and grown up and so forth, will know, literally know, Uncle so-and-so and Uncle such-and-so, who is in fact by then chief minister or minister in the government, and who will say, you know, you're a bright fellow, why don't you come into politics? It's not a dynastic succession, always. Sometimes it might be, but on the whole, not. It goes to the whole series of, as I say, it's a hobby horse of mine, and I'll go on forever if I don't stop at this point. But I do think, I just urge you, when you see the word dynasty, cross it out and say political family firm, which is what operates much like the family firms that we know about in business houses, and operates, in fact, like traditional bureaucratic families. I'm sure you know about, you've known some traditional bureaucratic families where it's not called a dynastic succession when the father was in the IAS and the son goes into the IAS. Is that called a dynastic succession? I don't think so. Why should it be a dynastic succession just because it's politics? Well, because somehow the voters are, influenced in that fashion. They think of these people as royalty or something. I don't think so. No voter that I've ever talked to thought of politicians as royalty. Anyhow, so I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sudhir Pandey. I come from Lucknow. I teach here.
TK.
At this university. Don't you think that Indian universities, particularly government state universities, whether they are in big cities like Lucknow and Delhi, or they are colleges, government colleges in small towns, they're the breeding grounds for these politicians, Indian politicians, and there is a close connection between teaching as a profession and, education and Indian politics, because most of the politicians are, earlier they were teachers, and these new leaders, young leaders,
right.
I also participated in Lucknow University, so they come from that, that is a kind of training ground for them, don't you think? There's okay. A strong connection.
I absolutely agree with you. I'm going to ask you a question in return. Why did you use the term breeding grounds? What other things have breeding grounds?
And because if you visit hostels generally in those universities, and there are people who are not actually students, but they live in the hostel and they train people.
No, I understand what you're saying. That's absolutely true. But I'm just taking the terminology here. Huh? Breeding ground to me, anyhow, what else goes on in breeding grounds? Well, mosquitoes come out of breeding grounds, Swamps are breeding grounds, right? It's got a negative thing to it, right? Why don't you say, let's try and think of a different word. Yeah, I think that's true. You're absolutely right. Universities have been throughout history, I think, critically important. Why? Because people are feeling their, it's a stage of adolescence, if you wish. They're becoming people. They're becoming persons. They're trying out their ideas. They're trying out their physical strength. They're trying out their social skills. They're trying out all kinds of things. in preparation for a later life. And the university is a very good place, particularly hostels are a terrific place for doing that, because you can you have time and it's a, as an, there's an equality and so on that, that is there. But you know, it's a training ground, maybe, I don't know what, but there should be a positive word for this rather than breeding ground. This is that's what I would say. But you're right about that.
But the second part is that in private universities, I mean, that is not the reality.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess I haven't had the experience in private private universities.
That is, politics is seen as not a kind of very good thing, because
Go ahead. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, for the education benefit, because I mean, obviously they. Create ruckus in the university, all those leaders. That is what I have seen, and we all the time. I mean, and there is a.
I think again, I'm going to. This is really seat of the pants. You know, not. I won't call it theorizing or anything like that. This is guesswork. Huh? My guess is that what we're talking about here is not a private-public distinction, but a subject matter distinction. Engineering colleges, medical colleges are not as susceptible to this kind of thing. And that's partly, I think, because of the nature of those particular, the people who choose to go into those things. They're coming out of, again, very often professional families who say, yeah, I'm an engineer, I'm an accountant, whatever, my son's going to be an accountant, so on, and partly that. But I think it's also, there's something about, I mean, this is a sort of a seat of the pants kind of a theoretical thing about China. It's always struck me that a surprising number of Chinese political leaders are engineers. And I think that an authoritarian dominant government like the Chinese fits with the engineering view of the world, which is to say everything fits together and everything works. If you push here, something down there happens. Whereas people who work in the humanities and other sorts of areas know that if you push here, it doesn't happen at the other end. Engineers expect things to work as systematic ways, which non-engineers don't. So whether, and I suspect that those places, which are engineering, who are the last places I'd look for, the day-to-day politics that I'm talking about. However, the engineers disproportionately are caught up in ideological politics of the left and of the right. In a way, their ideas are there, because they believe in principles rather than compromise and practicals. Engineers don't compromise if they can help it. That's the.
I'm Sharik Laliwala, and I study management. But what?
Think of yourself as an engineer, or
not really. So my question is on a different ground altogether. Your project somehow looks into, at certain level, in the social psychology of understanding the Indian politician.
Right.
But how would you also look into theorizing the Indian politician by the Indian politician themselves? Is it an altruistic portrayal? Is it a portrayal that changes with election? Or is it a portrayal which also changes with the election? And that theorizing happens with themselves. How do you look at that theorizing?
Yeah, okay. I think elections are a wonderful time to see. This is an election, sort of the natural experiment to find out how politicians behave and what they think is at election time, obviously, because everything gets heightened. And their true character, as it were, may show up in election time. So I've come to see elections and been part of election campaigns and getting a sense of what it is that goes on. My interpretation of these things, again, has been much less negative than most people's. I'll just give you one very simple example. I was once off in the back of the beyond of UP, and being back of the beyond of UP is really back in the beyond, in eastern UP. And there was some function, some clinic was being inaugurated, and they'd managed to invite, at that time, a minister of state and major East UP politician, now dead, Kalpanath Rai. I don't know how many people have an image of Kalpanath Rai, but I can tell you that he looked like and acted like the classic thug politician, you know, sort of as wide as he was tall, with lots of big guys around him kind of a guy, right? And he arrived at this opening just like this, like a classic politician, like, you know, Dabang, huh? Okay, that kind of politician, all right? He then got up, and he was Minister of State, it turns out, for in energy or something. I'd forgotten what the thing was. He gave a half an hour talk, which was, I don't know who was listening to it or why, on alternate energy. This is now, I'm talking now about 20 years ago, or more even, 25 years ago, on alternate energy, solar energy, biogas, stuff, just what you can imagine these people were interested in hearing. It was, he had obviously been briefed by his civil servants to answer questions in Parliament, so he had it all at the top of his head, and this is what he was telling us. And he was looking straight at me, I don't know why, but but I was addressed. I said, fantastic. He was on top of it, he knew it. Now here's a guy who's, and he was a thug, I think. I hope nobody, no relative is going to sue me for defamation, but anyhow, he was, you know, a classic East UP politician, and yet he had gone somehow to the trouble of memorizing that. At the time I was involved in this, I had an understanding of it. Fantastic. How do you put these two things together? And it's very difficult to do, but in election time, in this sort of time, is a good time to find out, I think, where people are in that respect. Now, what I'm going to come up with, I don't know. Because that's the whole point of, that's the fun of being, that's why we guys do research, right? You don't know what the answer is. You're going to find the answer. It's like solving puzzles. And let's see what happens.
Hello. Yeah. Could you elaborate on similarities between Indian politician and American politician with regard to use of sensational issues during elections, like Mr. Trump is doing in U.S. In the forthcoming U.S. presidential elections?
Sorry, what was the middle part of that? I didn't hear.
Yeah, similarities between Indian politicians and American politicians,
right?
Regarding use of raising sensational issues during elections, like Mr. Trump is doing in U.S. now, and some political parties in India use some sensational issues during elections in India.
Yeah, well, I mean, the name of the game in the U.S. certainly is, as they say, you know, getting eyeballs, right? So the more sensational the issue is, the more television coverage you get and so forth. And people have been pointing this out about, you know, Trump has gotten huge amounts because every time he gives a speech, he says something outrageous. And the television cameras want to be there. So-and-so is over there, Mr. Bernie Sanders is over there making a speech, and he's talking sense, and he doesn't make any outrageous statements, and so the television doesn't bother with him, right? And why does the television bother with Trump making outrageous statements and bringing in people? Because people just want to see this, you know, sort of like people falling off a building. You'd like to see it happen, and then they put an ad in, and they sell their product, and so forth and so on, and that's, you know, how it goes. So I'm not so sure that there's any, I mean, it would be an interesting sort of research project to see how much sensational, you know, that kind of statement goes on and so on. We're in a very unusual election right now in the U.S. where we've got quite a few people making sensational statements. It's no accident, it seems to me, that in fact this has generated a certain interest and so forth in politics, which maybe it's got, I mean, whether it's good or bad, it is not clear to me. Maybe the people who come tune in to see Trump make a sensational statement stick around and listen a little bit to some of the other candidates who make less sensational statements, or maybe even talk about politics in certain ways. Is there any difference between Indian and American politics in that respect? I think they're very similar. I mean, I feel much at home when I'm here. And I think that this is, I mean, the same sorts of things go on. But I've been very impressed with the extent to which, you know, the politicians, when they give those speeches, you sit and listen to those speeches, some of them are really clever in terms of how they raise it. I mean, I still remember in my mind VP Singh going around describing Rajiv Gandhi walking around with a Bofors bribe in his pocket. really clever, smart sorts of things. There's much more direct these days. There's the politics of India today reminds me very much more of the politics that I grew up with in the US now 50 years ago, 60 years ago, where there were actual face-to-face things. Television has not yet taken over entirely the interaction between politician and the voter, as it has in America. We almost never see a politician in the flesh, and most voters never see a politician in the flesh. Most audiences nowadays are there because for television purposes. I mean, you can't have a candidate speaking to thin air, so you bring in 1,000 people, but those people are very carefully chosen so that they produce the right kinds of reactions, the right kinds of speeches. So it's much more a staged operation in America than it is in India. Not to say that there aren't staged political rallies and things like that here as well, but I think it's less, so far less. But I rather suspect that as more and more people migrate to their TV screens and say, well, why should I get up and go outside and wait for a politician to show up 3 hours or 4 hours or 10 hours late, as does happen in the countryside, when I can watch him on TV later on. And that's going to happen, and I think it's a shame, actually. I think the face-to-face contact in politics, I think, is very important, and particularly at election time. And we've lost that in the U.S., and I think part of that result is that we get this kind of sensationalist politics that you're talking about.
Before I ask my question, I would just like to comment on the American politics that you just spoke about. I think while United States is thinking that it's the election, it's going into an election for its next presidential race, I mean, to elect its next president, the rest of the world is seeing it as America's, what is the average, how rational is the average American going to be in while he's going to choose the next president? I mean, it's just the way they have been voting in the primaries, I think it's the average, the sanity. I don't know what's happening, I mean. It's just hilarious what's happening. And while you said that it's more about television, I mean, in India also similar things happen. There are lots of people who would like to do like to see such speeches on televisions, but it rarely is the case that such a preposterous, such an extremist or a preposterous person would translate, they would like it on television, but when it comes to voting, I think people would rationalize their choices and it would translate into something more average, not as extreme as what at least I feel I'm seeing in the US elections. My school that I went to, the college that I went to, I just read recently, Georgia Tech, gun laws, the Georgia gun law has been passed and students can carry guns law at Georgia Tech, and I was just surprised. And I don't think something as close to that would even happen in India, at least in the near future.
I mean, speaking as an American citizen, I agree with you absolutely that it's sort of thing. I mean, to claim that we're a civilized country when we allow this sort of thing to happen, it's not just in Georgia Tech, it's at the University of Texas in Austin where I've taught, where you're now, they cannot prevent students from carrying their weapons onto the campus and into the dormitory. I think they're not allowed to bring them into the classroom yet, but it'll come because there are people who want to do that. Somehow, again, the usual retreat that everyone has here is okay, fine, this is a terrible system, it's generating awful things in the world, but it's better than the alternative. Huh? It's better than the alternative of, say, military rule or something else authoritarian. A democracy with all its faults and all the craziness that goes on, and it's been going on for an awfully long time, and injustices that go on, is on balance a least worst system. Now, that's not something you can fall in love with. I mean, how many times do you fall in love with the least worst system? And again, particularly for engineers, least worst is not what they want, right? They want the best. It's, I think, you know, what's going on in America. I mean, I'm the eternal optimist. I think that the Republican Party in particular, and Donald Trump in particular, and or Ted Cruz for that matter, are digging themselves into a hole of unelectability. That what plays the, and remember that Trump is only getting 30% of the Republican vote. And the Republican vote is roughly 50%. Actually, designated Republicans are in fact 40%. We have a significant number of so-called independents who are either Republican leading or Democrat leading. So, and it looks to me anyhow that if Donald Trump is nominated, that vote share will go up a little bit, but not anywhere close to the 50% that he needs. In the critical states, and we have of course a terribly biased system of electing the presidents, where it's perfectly possible to win the popular vote and lose the electoral vote and not be president. But I don't think that's going to happen with Trump's case or Cruz, and no matter who the Democratic Party nominee is. But that's my highly amateur guess about American politics.
Okay. Coming to my question, it was seeing the last election that just went by, and as you said, that Indian system is parliamentary system, whereas it's the presidential system in the US. Don't you think that the Indian system is moving from parliamentary to presidential, as in there's a central figure emerging out of each party, and it rotates around that one person. However good a local candidate is, the vote will be casted based on who the central leadership is. Yeah. So don't you think Indian system is moving towards that? And if it is it that a good or a bad thing?
I agree with you absolutely, and I like to claim that in, and of course this is a typical scholarly language, huh? In a footnote of an article that I wrote in 1988, I said exactly this, more or less the same thing, that Indian elections are becoming presidential. This was an article about the 1984 election. And I say that I believe that, and I went back and looked at earlier elections, going back to 1971, basically, saying that each one of these elections, the person who is clearly, the leader and the presidential, the fact that voters want someone who can make a decision that will stick. And that's much more like a presidential system than saying the voters want a party or a set of parties that can come together somehow to make decisions that stick, which is what happens in a parliamentary system with coalition parties. In between, there was an era in which coalitions seemed to be settling down in certain ways so that people looked much more like a traditional parliamentary system. But since then, and particularly in the 2014 election, I think it's absolutely correct that you have a presidential contest going on. And as my wife will tell you, one of the most effective TV ads was the one of the cartoon characters saying, you know, where's the cricket captain? Where's the captain of the other side? And it hasn't shown up. It's recognized within the system that there's got to be someone who is in charge. And I think that's true. I mean, I think that is, I would argue, for example, in 1977 election. On the one side, you had Indira Gandhi, clearly. On the other side, you didn't have a leader. It was a hodgepodge. It was a Khichdi, became a Khichdi, and so forth. But the voters saw Jai Prakash Narayan as someone who could decisively say who the prime minister would be, who would form the government. And they were right. And therefore, they feel that they could vote for the Janata in its very odd form. Now it turned out, of course, that it couldn't stick together. But in terms of the election, I think that's critically. Voters do not wish to reject a singular person in favor of an unknown quantity on the other side.
Phil,
whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, I don't know. I mean, there are costs and benefits to both of these things. But I think the voters, you have to trust the voters.
Phil, can you help me understand and put in the context a conversation that I had years ago with Ashok Bhatt, who was a very powerful local politician at the city level and then at the state level, and maybe to some degree national, but really city and state. I was interviewing him, and he said he was very proud of his election, his electoral wins. He said he had been elected 5 times in a row from the same constituency. And what struck me was, well, of course from the same constituency, but people tell me, no, it's very difficult to be reelected from the same constituency, and most politicians run from different constituencies because they can't be reelected from the same one. I've talked to people about that, but could you give me your views on that?
Okay, I will give a little preface to this. I once tried to work on this by looking at incumbency of particular individuals. And I finally I didn't do this in the days before having a spreadsheet and or access to this sort of stuff. Indian politicians have a really nasty habit of changing the way their names are put into the candidates. So the R.K. Singh of this election turns is Ram Kishore Singh in the next election is, you know, who knows what in the third election. So you don't quite know who's who, and you have to go to find out. So my effort to do this collapsed on that particular small point. There were too many people who did this. I do not think that people shift constituencies, no. I don't think that's correct. Most people stick to their same constituency. But there is definitely an anti-incumbency feeling in any number of parts of the country, certainly. And I think that it's probably a feeling. I mean, this is what people, voters have told me, roughly, saying, you know, I'm voting for this guy, but next time I'll vote for someone else, because these people have to understand that they don't have a sinecure here. They can't just expect to be voted. We've got to give them a jolt. Sometimes. And the people who are sitting there say, I know that they know that's going to happen. And so they start doing what they can in order to keep their voters. Now, some of that's not pretty. Some of it is pretty in the sense that if they work extra hard to get benefits for their constituency, well, you know, what's to be difficult about? I think the classic case in India is, and let's see what happens in this election, the case of the Kerala alternation in power. Since the mid-60s, there's been coalitions alternating in power, left coalition, a Congress-led coalition, left coalition, Congress-led coalition. And it's been, on the whole, a positive process because the people who get the coalition that gets elected, in fact, and people have said, I haven't verified this, put into actually implement the programs of the previous government. They say, these guys put together a program. We're going to make it run. They didn't. They weren't able to do it, and the result then has been a positive circle in Kerala. Arguably, to bring it up to the national level, this is something that people might say about the current government in Delhi. They campaigned against NREGA. They've adopted NREGA. They campaigned against Aadhaar. They've adopted Aadhaar. And they're doing it in a way which suggests, but then they run the risk of the voters saying, well, you've done that for me, now what? And you're getting high and mighty, we'll take you down a peg. And I think that that's possible.
Last question, one more, two more.
Sir, in India there are cultural and ideological In India, there are cultural and ideological organizations on both left and right way who want to control the government by remote control, and they don't want to sit in parliament and rule.
Yeah.
And how far this is an advantage for democracy or not, sir? And the second question is regarding there was a controversy in 2009. We are using now this thing, ballot, instead of ballot papers, there's a machines.
Right.
How dangerous are these machines? So if there is some technical fault?
Well, I'm not equipped to answer the technical point on the second. My impression is that since the machines are not connected to other machines, that it's not a serious problem. But that's the testimony of chief election commissioners and people like that who have a vested interest in seeing this thing working. But I can't make a judgment about that. The first point was about, remind me the...
Remote control.
The remote control. This is actually is one of the interesting things, one major difference between the American system and a parliamentary system. In the American system, the party president and the party as a whole is really weak compared to the elected officials. Typically the party person is appointed by the president or whomever, or is changed when the new president comes into power and things of that sort. In a parliamentary system, on the other hand, you have many, many cases of the party, and take Britain as a classic case, where the trade unions at the time of a Labour government were told the government what to do. Said, this is what you're supposed to do. We are the movement, you're just the executive arm of our movement. There is a sense in which the parties are typically much stronger in a parliamentary system than they are, and there are many party leaders who stay in the background and tell the prime minister what to do based on what the party wants or the constituents of the party. That's inherent in the parliamentary system, which involves, after all, pulling together, the party pulling together the government. The prime minister is simply the leader of the party in parliament. Is it a good thing or a bad thing in a democracy? Well, it's not because it's good or bad that it happens. In other words, I don't see this as evil, evil people manipulating things. I think that there's certain people who have a taste for being in the background, who don't want to give speeches, who don't want to stand up, but do want to be our politicians, who do think in politics and policy terms, perhaps, and so forth. And I don't see that there's any inherent reason why they should be harmful to the system just because they want to stay out of the limelight, as long as the party system is reasonably open and that people can find out at least what they do. And most of the time it leaks, you know who is there, and sometimes it's pretty obvious, as when Sonia Gandhi was head of a National Advisory Commission. I don't think that that was an illegitimate exercise and function. I don't think it was, in fact, even a super cabinet. It generated ideas. And I don't think that it's, again, you can imagine that there would be a party that would, in fact, make decisions for the government. And some people argued, for example, the CPM did this in Bengal, that the power of the party necessarily, not after Jyoti Basu left, was not in the hands of the chief minister, not in the hands of his cabinet, it was in the hand of the Politburo. So it's not simply, a party of any particular ideological party where this happens. I think it's, as I say, inherent in the system. Again, it seems to me that the other thing, one has to differentiate between what I would say is day-to-day politics and critical moment politics. Day-to-day politics, this is something that happens, and most people say, fine, let it go. Let them do this, let them put the policies in, so forth. But on critical issues where the nation's existence is at stake or something really important, the most recent example that I can think of that I was present for in India was the debate on the India-US nuclear treaty, which was a critical debate. That debate took place in Parliament, and that battle was won and lost in Parliament, not in the party offices. And I think that that's what happens in critical things, will be decided in the party and the elected politician side rather than the backroom boys side. Day-to-day politics, day-to-day administration, day-to-day policies even, will be much more in the hands of that. Now, on balance, is this a good thing or a bad thing? I don't know. I think it's just natural to the system, though.
Last question.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Oldenburg. May I request Professor Anurag Mehra, Professor at Institute of Engineering and Technology and Dean of Planning at Ahmedabad University, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Well, it's sad to see interesting conversations coming to an end, but all good things must come to an end. So on behalf of the CEPT community and the AU community, please join me in thanking Professor Oldenburg for a very insightful and a provocative talk. Thank you.
Thank you all. See you at the next CEPT AU lecture. Have a good evening.